brother Eli, would you like to come and walk right here when you're done? Well, good morning. What a beautiful day it is to be in the house of the Lord. It's raining on the inside, maybe it'll rain on the outside. It's raining on the outside, maybe it'll rain on the inside too. We've been talking about evangelism. We looked at Mark chapter 16 and verse 13, where the Bible states, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." It's not a suggestion, but it's a command. He didn't say, if you want to go, but he said, go. And we've been looking at evangelism for a while. Last 2 weeks, we listened to a CD on a man give his testimony on when God took him to hell and gave him a vision of hell. Bill Weiss's, he wrote a book, 23 Minutes in Hell. From there, I hope we got a better sense that hell is a real literal place. And every second, there are people dying, and they're either going to enter into heaven or they're going to enter into hell. But if we are going to effectively reach the lost, and we are effectively going to tell people about Christ and their need for Him before it's too late, first, we need to get a vision of hell. We need to get evangelistic eyesight, what I call it. William General Booth, he was the founder of the Salvation Army. He actually called himself General by title, and of course, he set up his organization as a military rank. So, as you went through and as you gained access, instead of being an elder or something, you might be a sergeant or a lieutenant, and so forth. But he said he would conclude his training, if he could, by hanging each one of his soldiers over hell for 24 hours to give them eyesight that there is a lost and dying world out there, to give them a burden for the lost. If we do not develop a burden for the lost, what's going to compel us, what is going to drive us to go and tell them about Christ before it's too late? If we do not develop a burden for the lost, then every individual that we pass every day is simply seen as just another individual. Maybe somebody that's annoying, maybe somebody that's funny, maybe somebody that's a major pain in the caboose. But we need to get spiritual eyesight. We need to get evangelistic eyesight, that we don't see them as the person that's annoying or this person or that person, but we need to view them as God views them, and that is as a soul. A soul that is going to either enter into heaven or they're going to enter into hell at the end of their lifetime. And as a church, it is our responsibility to reach the lost. Not the pastors, not just the council members, but each and every single one of us. We are the church. If someone would please read Proverbs chapter 29 and verse 18. Proverbs 29 and verse 18.
Where there is no vision, the people perish, but he who so lost happens.
Where there is no vision, the people perish. Do you know what happens to a church that's full of older people, and they don't want anybody else in their church? If there's no kids, the last individual that dies off, there goes the church. They have no vision, Brother Eli. They're not doing what they can just to reach out for Christ, but they're just content being there, and they just sit there until not only everyone there dies, but the entire church that they're dwelling in dies. If we don't develop a vision, then we're going to perish. Our church is going to perish. The kingdom of God isn't going to perish, but it's not what God expects it to be, because He expects each and every one of us to go out and win the lost. Charles Spurgeon said, "Have you no wish for others to be saved? Then you're not saved yourself. Be sure of that." Charles Spurgeon said that if you do not wish for anyone else to get saved, then you mustn't be saved either. How can you be so happy about going to heaven but taking no one else with you? What is one thing someone does when they find out something that they absolutely love? They got to tell absolutely everybody about it. Have you tried this? Have you gone there? Have you heard this? Have you seen that? I mean, it blew my mind. One thing that we as human beings do, if we find something we love, we're going to tell others about it. If we find something we hate, we're going to be sure to tell others about it. Don't buy that, that's garbage. Just get the other one, it's a little bit better. If we are truly excited about serving God and truly excited about going to heaven, then we're going to tell others about Christ. Because there is only one way into heaven. Regardless of what people in this world want to tell you, there's only one way to heaven, and that is through Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ himself said that. He said, I am the way. He didn't say you could get there through Buddha and Muhammad and every other religion. He didn't say you could get there on your own shirt tails or anything else. He said, it's only through me that people enter heaven. And he goes on to emphasize throughout his teaching that, broad is the way to destruction. Broad is the way to hell. But narrow is the way to heaven. He's also said that there will be many on that day that said, Lord, have we not done this? Have we not done that? And he'll say, I never knew you. Heaven and hell is a very serious issue. And every single individual that is alive, everyone that has breathed breath, is going to make that decision at some point in their lifetime. Are they going to serve God? Or are they going to go their own way? Are they going to enter into heaven? Or are they going to go by some way, go to hell? And there's lots of people that may not even be... Let me back up. I want to be careful how I say this. There might be lots of people that aren't aware that Jesus Christ is the only way into heaven. It doesn't matter, you go into the heathen world and they'll know that there's God, they'll know that there's one way to get saved, they'll even understand blood sacrifice. But what are we doing to tell others around us that, you know what, it doesn't matter what the world says, there's only one way into heaven, and that is through Jesus Christ. How are they going to know if we don't tell them? If we don't tell them, who will? David McGee said that we should be more concerned with reaching the lost than pampering the saved. It's easy to come to church. It's easy to worship God. It's easy to listen to the preacher preach because it's within our comfort zone. But to step outside of our comfort zone and ask somebody, hey, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? If you died today, do you know where you would end up in? Would you end up in heaven or would you end up in hell? What is your spiritual status? That takes us stepping outside of our comfort zone. Because then we get into the mentality sometimes of what other people think. Well, what will they think if I do this? Will they think I'm fanatical if I do that? What about this? Will I present it right? Or maybe I don't know enough about the Bible. If we don't tell them, who will? Charlie Pease was a prisoner on death row in England many, many years ago. And just prior to his execution, the minister read verses concerning hell. And when he was done, he said, Sir, if you really believed what you just quoted and read, if you really believe that, you would crawl, I personally would crawl from one side of England to the other on my hands and knees across sharp pieces of glass that one person might be saved if hell is really that bad. If you truly believe that, we have the truth, but what are we doing with it? If we would think about our own lives for a moment, and we would begin thinking about our responsibilities, what are we responsible for? What do we have to take care of? And if we sit down and ponder that for a minute, it probably wouldn't take long before we start developing a list. I mean, we could probably do that instantaneously. You know, for myself, it's a matter of making sure I show up to work, making sure my bills are paid, not just paid, but paid on time, making sure my doors are locked up at the end of the night, making sure that my household is safe, protecting my wife, making sure that everything is secure, making sure that my car has gas in it, making sure that the cars are maintained, making sure that we're not riding around on flat tires because then you gotta buy new tires. And the list goes on and on. Other people might be washing dishes, making sure the laundry's done, making sure the floors are swept, making sure that there's heating oil or pellets, or making sure the house is prepared the way it should be, making sure it's warm, making sure the roof isn't leaking. If something goes wrong, you know you're responsible. If the kitchen sink is leaking, you know you have to get under there and fix it. I mean, the list goes on and on. We all can think of stuff almost just like that that we're responsible for. But one thing that is really seldom on that list is the fact that we as Christians are responsible for souls. God said, not if you go, but he said, go. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. It is our responsibility. Before we can truly see souls saved, guess where it begins? Right here. Getting ourselves ready, making sure that we are right with God. And if we are right with God, we've been coming to church for a million years, and we know that everything is in order, then we need to start working on ourselves, that we develop a burden and a vision to reach the lost. Because it is our responsibility. And we can come to church and we can talk about revival all we want, but if we really do not have a burden for souls, why should God give us revival? Because what revival is a bringing back to life, a renewing. And part of that renewing is outreach, evangelism, reaching the lost. Not just God sending down his spirit heavier than he has before, but then the responsibility falls upon us as well to tell others about Christ. Because guess what? Have you ever been anywhere before? Maybe you were looking at something, or maybe you weren't exactly sure where you were at, but then somebody came by and informed you on what you were looking at, or maybe where you were at, and then, oh, now I get it. The Holy Ghost can deal with people. God can send his spirit down in such a mighty way that we've never known before. That conviction falls upon everyone in the valley, but unless they know what is going on, not going to come to Christ, because they may not realize that it's conviction. Or they may know that God's dealing with them, but they're not sure how to get it right. And guess whose responsibility it is to guide them? It is ours. It is our responsibility to reach the lost. Would someone please read, well, I'll go ahead and read it. Matthew 25, 14 through 30. Matthew 25, 14 through 30. Matthew 25, verses 14 through 30. Excuse me. For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to every man according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey. And he that had received the 5 talents went and traded with the same and made them 5 other talents. And likewise, he that had received 2, he also gained other 2. But he that had received 1 went and digged in the earth and hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants cometh and reckoneth with them. And so he that had received 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained beside them 5 talents more. His Lord said unto him, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things, I will make thee ruler over many things. And enter thou into the joy of the Lord. He also that had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 2 talents. Behold, I have gained 2 other talents beside them. His Lord said unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. Then he which had received the one talent came and said, Lord, I knew thee that thou art an hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown, and gathering where thou hast not strawed. And I was afraid and went and hid thy talent in the earth. Lo, thou hast that is thine. His Lord answered and said unto him, Thou wicked and slothful servant, thou knewest that I reap where I sow not, and gather where I have not strawed. Thou oughtest therefore to have put my money to the exchangers, and then at my coming I should have received mine own with usury. Take therefore the talent from him, and give it unto him which hath 10 talents. And unto every one that hath shall be given, and he shall have abundance. But from him that hath not shall be taken away even that which he hath. And cast ye that unprofitable servant into outer darkness, there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. We are responsible for what God has given us. We've attended church. We know enough of the gospel message to lead someone to Christ. Even if we don't know the verses, we know that Jesus Christ was the Son of God that came to earth. He was born because Adam sinned. And the reason he born was that he may die, and 3 days later he rose again. That is the salvation message. The birth, the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And we are responsible to tell others about Christ before it's too late. And we must realize that the responsibility of reaching the lost is done through people. Not just the pastor, not just the elders, the deacons, not just the missionaries or evangelists, but through everyday, ordinary people. Doesn't matter class, rank, or status. If someone would go ahead and read Luke chapter 10 and verse 20, Luke 10, 20, and Matthew 9, 37 and 38. Luke 10, 20, and Matthew 9, 37 to 38.
Luke 10, 20. Notwithstanding in this, rejoice not, the Spirit is subject to you, rather rejoice because you are in the service of God.
And what about Matthew chapter 9, 37 to 38? Matthew 9, 37 to 38.
Then says he unto his disciples, the harvest is beautiful, the labor is few. Pray therefore for the harvest, that he will send forth laborers into the harvest.
The fields are white already. Pray that the Lord will send forth laborers. Did he say pastors? Did he say missionaries? Did he say evangelists? No, he said laborers. He didn't classify whether it should be a certain position held within the church. He just said laborers. And we have to realize that we are God's witnesses, therefore we are his laborers. In Acts chapter 1 and verse 8, the Bible states, But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. We are his witnesses. It is our responsibility to take the gospel message to those who have not heard it. It is our responsibility to tell others about Christ. And we need to get a vision that is not just our responsibility, but we must get a burden and a realization of the time frame, that time is limited. We find that in John chapter 9, and verse 4, John 9, 4, where the Bible states, I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can work. We can go to the book of James and realize that life is but a vapor. Brother Elam, before you know it, is going to be gone. A puff of smoke. But time is not limited just by our death. But we preach it and we rejoice in it all the time that Jesus Christ is coming back at any moment. And we preach that he could be back in the next minute and the next 30 seconds. And the whole while we're rejoicing, what have we been doing throughout our lifetime to reach others for Christ? That when he does come, that they may be ready as well. Time is limited, and we are responsible to tell others about Christ before it's too late. It is our responsibility to take the gospel message to the nations. Once again, Mark 16, 15. He didn't say go if you want, but he just said go. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. You know, and sometimes it's easier to pray that, God, you send somebody to tell them about Christ. Yes, I realize that crazy Phil, he has a soul, he needs to be saved, but God, I don't want to talk to him. You go send somebody to tell him about Christ. Many years ago, there's a Pentecostal preacher by the name of Lester Sumrall, and this is the big event that he's known for. Many, many, many moons ago, in a land far, far away, in the state of Indiana, where everything's flat, except for the landfills, there was a preacher by the name of Lester Sumrall. And he came across a newspaper article about this strange woman in the Philippines, out in Manila. Upon reading the article, he realized what was wrong with her. He knew that she was demon-possessed. That was the reason for all her outbreaks. So he began praying, God, you send somebody. Send somebody there to deliver her. God, send someone there to deliver her from all her demons. God, set her free. God, send somebody. And you know what the answer was from God? You go. Well, sometimes that's the hardest thing we can hear.
Sure.
It's easy to say, you know what, I don't want to deal with crazy Phil, bro. God, you send Brother Eli down to him. He can talk to him. He can show him the love of Christ. But what happens when God says, you go? God's words to Lester Sumrall, taken from his book, Demons and Answer Book, Lester Sumrall stated that God told him, if you go and pray for her, I will deliver her. But the stipulation was this, if you go, then I'll deliver her. How many people are out there waiting just for us to come by and tell them about Christ? How many people out there are in a drug-fested state that are just waiting for somebody to come along and show them Christ? How many people are out there addicted to alcohol that are just waiting for somebody to come along and to show them the way to accept Christ as a personal Savior, to change everything around? Maybe it's going to be your responsibility to reach out and tell them about Christ. We have a huge evangelistic outreach coming up here. What do I mean by that? There are two large buildings that are low-income housing that we're going to get people bussed in for. Whose responsibility is it to take the word of Jesus Christ to them? Whose responsibility is it to reach them with Christ? It is our responsibility. But we need to get a vision for the lost before it's too late. We can realize that it's our responsibility all we want. There are lots of things we do because it's our responsibility that we don't want to do. Trust me, I do not go to Walmart 40 hours a week because I want to go there. I go there because every month I have this guy named Bill that shows up in my mailbox with several of his friends. There's the electric bill, the mortgage bill, the credit card bill. I don't like Bill. But we go to our workplaces sometimes, not because we want to, but because it's our responsibility. And I don't go because I have a burden to make Walmart rich. I have a burden because I like to heat and I like to eat. I like to make sure that my stuff's taken care of. There is a difference between knowing that it's our responsibility and developing a burden and a sense of urgency to reach out to people before it's too late. We need to get that burden. We need to get God to impress His love upon our hearts for the lost. We need to get a sense of urgency that time is short, and if we don't tell them, who will? There are fanatical religious groups that are out there that they don't care who they offend or what they do. They don't care if we think they're nuts. Radical Islam being one of them. They will literally kill people for their faith. When we are to do the opposite, we are to save people for our faith. Introduce them to Jesus Christ before it's too late. They are fanatical about their religion. They are engulfed in it. They are pushed by it. They are motivated by it. But yet, we can realize that it's our responsibility to reach others for Christ. But what's pushing us? What's motivating us? It should be the fact that God's heart breaks for the lost. We talked about this in past weeks. Jesus Christ was not born of a virgin to die on a cross to give us pastors, evangelists, preachers, teachers. There was only one reason he came into this world, and that was to seek and to save that which is lost. It is our responsibility to seek out those which are lost, that we may introduce them to Jesus Christ, that he may save them from their sin, that he may stop them from going to hell, and give them a new life in him. But if we do not tell them, who will? We may be the only salvation that people around us have. There may be no one else willing to tell them about Jesus Christ. We may be the only ones willing to lay hands on an individual to cast out a demon. We may be the only ones with enough access to the throne of God to lay hands on the sick and to see them recover. And I'm not talking about a simple cough. I'm talking about people stepping out of wheelchairs, regaining full mobility. I'm talking about cancer being cured on a full body scale from head to toe. I'm talking about limbs that may have been cut off being grown back. Deliverance from drugs, deliverance from alcohol. We are living in one of the enemy's strongholds. People, we don't have to go far to see people addicted by drugs, alcohol, heroin. More and more we're hearing about needles being tossed here and in parking lots and playgrounds. These people don't need another shot. They don't need another rehab. What they need is Jesus. He is the one that breaks every chain. He is the one that grants full deliverance. He is the only way into heaven. We have the truth. What are we doing with the truth? We know how to get to Christ. We know how to enter into heaven. But are we keeping it to ourselves? Are we developing a burden for the lost? Not just enough to realize that it's our responsibility. We need to develop a burden. We need to develop a sense of urgency. And if we don't have it, there's only going to be one way to really get it. And that is finding ourselves a place of prayer, getting on our knees, and becoming more like Christ than ever before. Finding ourselves under the shadow of the Almighty, that he may change us into the image of Jesus Christ. Because Christianity is not just a